Yes.
Welcome to the Layman's Seminary. My wife and I were continuing our series on debate preparation for my debate with CJ Cox, which is tomorrow. And one of the videos that we were doing, the debate preparation videos, somebody in the chat said that we were poisoning the well. So my wife asked what poisoning the well is. And so that's what we're going to do. We're just going to take a look at different descriptions of what poisoning the well is. And we'll go forward from that. Okay.
Oh, that's a lot. Yeah. Logically,
All right.
hilarious.
Yeah. Where's the picture? All right. So
Where's
go ahead. Start at the beginning.
is that poisoning the well? Okay. Poisoning the well to commit a pre what? Preemptive.
Preemptive.
What that
It
means?
means to
Preemptive.
strike first,
Strike
like
first.
Cobra Kai, right?
Yeah, okay, go back. Okay. To
Strike
commit
first.
an preemptive ad hominem attack
Yeah, so you strike first against the person instead of the
against.
argument.
I love you so much, my husband. You are the vocabulary. My vocabulary.
Okay, keep
Attack.
going.
Attack against an opponent. That is. To prime the audience with, see, I just know it. Adverse information about the opponent from the start in an attempt to make your claim more acceptable or discount the credibility of your opponent's claim. Yeah, that's not understanding when he said that poisoning the well.
Right. But see, so that what they're saying is me making these, what, 13 videos on debate preparation, it's
Yeah.
poisoning the well because I'm attacking before we do the debate. But I'm not
Yeah.
attacking the person, I'm attacking the issue. Now, when the
Yeah.
person has attacked me, it says I don't know Greek, says that I'm a heretic, says that I'm not as extreme as Josh Gibbs. I challenge that, you know. But that's okay, let's look at some other definitions.
Thank you, because I have that in mind while during on your debate, and questioning the law.
I don't think that's a good example.
Yeah, because it's not open. Oh, water danger. What's that? Description. You want me to read?
Yeah, look at this one. This one's from Facebook.
This one, that's
Okay, read it.
which where to start? That one, okay.
Right here.
Logical fallacy of the week, poisoning the well. This information fallacy is characterized by the introduction of irrelevant prejudicial information, true or not, about an opponent in an attempt to preemptively discount the credibility to their evidence or argument. Is that person reading this? Thomas John's rebuttal to being caught in a sting operation run by Susan Garbick and Mark Edward, which demonstrated that John Reed planted fake social media info during his mediumship show, as was revealed in the New
As
York
Susan
Times.
to come to a reading and say, well, I made a fake post about my dog, Buddy, and my father who died. It's really not any sort of scientific test in the psychic powers. Someone will have to be a scientist to do a scientific experiment, not someone who used to be a photographer at Sears. So they're saying that's poisoning the well. I don't, you know, the point is, Janet, is that it says prejudicial information. What do you mean by presidential information? Anybody can claim that something's presidential information. And see, that's why I don't like fallacies because you can always claim them, you know? Like I told you, that book about how to win any argument, the use and abuse of logic. And so you got many of these examples here. Look at this
Cooking.
one. Look at this one.
Okay, big, make it big. Thank you.
So this is Obama. And I don't want that. They won't let me see it. Anyway,
Do you
I'll
need
tell
to
you
pay?
what's in this picture is Obama's
Okay.
pouring executive orders down the well, right? And then the elephant, which represents the gosh, I can't remember. Oh my gosh, I feel so dumb as an American right now. Because I can't remember if the elephant, I think it's the Republican Party. And the donkey is a Democrat. Yeah, it's the
Republican.
Republican elephant. I just wanted to make sure. So Obama's a Democrat, right? And he's pouring down the executive orders. And they're down the well. And then they're looking the Republicans, and according to this, now this is not a, this I'm not making a political thing. We're just explaining what we see. The Republicans are accusing him because he made decisions and pouring it down the well, that he's poisoning the well. But actually, it's the Republican that has the poison in the well. So my point is that sometimes this is good what we found this. Sometimes, according to this, now this is not reality, all right? I'm not making a statement about reality, but
It's
sometimes the accusation of poisoning the well is
they are the one.
actually a smokescreen or covering up because they're poisoning the well. And that's why Janet said, which well? Okay, so good
There
job,
will
Janet.
or thank you.
All
I
right.
love you.
Love you too. Okay, so we were talking about falsifiability, all right? Now we're moving forward. So if I, this is the thing. If I convince CJ of a passage's interpretation, he can always claim that the audience is not necessarily saved, right? We talked about that
I
in his
disagree with
view.
that. Yeah,
Right.
audience.
Yeah, and you'll have to see the previous video, see what we're talking about.
Yes, guys,
So what
go
I
there
intend to do is to expose some of the main
do that and click like and share to others.
I intend to expose some of the main things feeding the system.
Okay.
All right. I got a copycat right there. I'll have to delete that. Then I'll let him pick the battlefield, which is any passage he mentions, and you will see our system at work. See, because if I start out the way I started out, you notice I haven't used any scripture. So somebody will say, oh, you just made a bunch of statements, but you aren't quoting scripture. Oh, yeah? Well, pick a scripture. Any scripture.
Yeah, sure, right, guys?
I don't need a proof text.
Yes,
My chart
need.
analyzes every passage.
Yeah, you need my husband to explain what he just said. So pick up the scriptures and tell him what you're understanding, and he will tell you about the truth of the passage that you pick it up.
Okay, so everyone has a system, but the goal is to have a biblical system, right? Because what was the name of the debate? What we're talking about is true biblical salvation. Okay,
What is true biblical salvation?
so I will try to wait, he will try, sorry. He will try to charge me with antinomianism, right?
Yeah, antinomianism, please explain. It's
Against the law.
the law.
And positionally, we're not antinomian because we believe in the law, that the command is to believe the gospel. So we're positionally
Yeah.
obedient.
Amen.
Experientially, we don't believe we're not against the law code for the church age. So yeah.
Yes. I'm into
I said
that.
that this charge does not stick on experiential or positional grounds. He'll assert it. His concerns about free grace is because this system cannot give him assurance. And he thinks anything different from his system is heretical. He lacks assurance because if he goes by his arguments, he has no way to point in scripture and say, you know what? I'm saved because of what this scripture says. Because he can always be somebody in his system who is given temporary faith or false faith, and the devil makes him think he's saved, but it's really just emotion or whatever, and he's not really saved, you know. He claims that I'm a heretic. So what is the heresy?
Yeah. You know what? Lack of knowledge about the subject is really bad because, you know, it seems correct, but actually it's not. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
But it's not. If you're going to go deeper, dig more deeper of understanding about it's all about sanctification.
Right. He claims that I'm more extreme than Joshua Gibbs. So what on the basis for that distinction? What does Joshua Gibbs say that is different from what I say?
Yeah, and who's Joshua Gibbs?
The one that debated him that's free grace recently.
Oh, that person, okay.
I said, I think the reason he believes I'm extreme is because I directly confront his system.
Amen. That exactly. I agree to that. That's absolutely what's happening to him.
Other people don't directly confront. Even in a debate, they don't directly confront. They think they treat it more like a Bible study. And you can't treat a debate like a Bible study. I do Bible study in a debate, but it's different.
Yeah. No, no. There's something that the reason why they are not going to attack the system of the person because they don't want to lose them. They might be less of subscribers. I'm just saying that.
That's
not
a good point.
Not literally. Okay, just you know what I mean, right?
Yeah. Not it makes sense. Okay, so I probably will include the quote from Dillo in here. So let me just bring up Final Destiny.
Oh, I just have that Final Destiny. Yeah. Final Destiny at my back.
Yes, it's at your back.
And this one, I'm still reading. Not
Pentecost,
done yet.
Thy Kingdom Come.
Yeah, guys, it's not promoting, but it's really amazing. So please. Buy and read it.
All right.
Yeah. Is that the same version in with mine?
Yes, I think so.
Oh, you have that?
Okay. All right. Read this. Read this.
Where is it?
You don't see the words?
Which one?
The one that I'm highlighting.
Yeah, it was the doctrine, but it's gone now. What happened?
Janet, do you see my screen?
Yes.
Do you see the green?
Yeah. What I mean is earlier, there's a green highlighted. It's gone now.
Okay.
Start the doctrine, and I tried to find it, but you said that this one. Okay. One, what's one? The distinctive of the partner doctrine are this. Partner is
a subgroup of free grace.
The Greek word, sawa ko.
Oh, metakoi.
Yeah, metakoi. Those who have been born again will normally give some evidence of growth in grace and spiritual interest and commitment. John Harth say it well. It is not denied that genuine faith will result in some change in the believer. Those holding to the free grace teaching do not assert that faith can exist without any change whatsoever. Most, if not all, free grace proponents believe that good works will inevitably result from faith, but not necessarily as visibly as we desire them to appear, and not necessarily as consistent as the Lord would desire them to appear. The key words are visibly and consistently.
Okay, so if CJ will agree with that, then that's fine. I have a stronger argument, I think. But if CJ will agree with that, I'm fine with that. Not everybody's going to see free grace exactly like me, but I'd rather get him in the camp and let him decide between the tents, you know, or tribes. But go ahead, Janet.
So justification is by faith alone. Faith involves three things: believing, assent, personal persuasion, and confident trust in the finished work of Christ for the free gift of forgiveness of sins. Repentance, defined as admitting personal guilt, discipleship, or submission to Christ as Lord, are not conditions for salvation. Salvation is free gift of undeserved favor received by faith and is available without cost. Revelation 21:6. Whereas discipleship cost one's entire life, Matthew 16:25, because salvation involves trusting Christ for the forgiveness of sin. It is psychologically impossible to come to Christ for salvation and yet not admit personal guilt and need for a savior. One does not go to a physician unless he is sick and want to be healed.
Okay. Yeah. So if CJ will accept that, then that's great. But he doesn't want to give this one up.
Christ is Lord, and not are not conditioned. But yeah.
Okay, that's number three.
We just pray that CJ will, you know, the Holy Spirit will open the mind to understand the crisis. The assurance of salvation is found by looking outwardly to Christ, as the gospel promise and the beauty of the Redeemer are healed before the believer's gaze. Assurance is the result of such contemplation. Spiritual fruit is helpful as a secondary confirmation of one's regenerated state. Regenerated means born again, in other terms. But its absence does not necessarily invalidate one's salvation. If a believer is looking biblically and dependently to Christ, a lifestyle of sin will be psychologically, spiritually, and biblically impossible. Romans 6:1, 11, etc. Hebrews.
So if he can agree to that, that's great.
Yeah. Christians may fail to persevere in faith. Christians may fail to persevere in faith, and in some cases, they may even deny the faith altogether. Hebrews 3:12. While continuous growth in Christ is commanded in the New Testament, it is possible for a Christian to lapse into carnality and finish his course walking like an unsaved person. The automatic and necessary lifelong unity between justification and sanctification imagined by the experimental predestinarian is not taught in Scripture.
Okay. Now, he doesn't want to think this because he doesn't want to think that the people can actually deny the faith, that they can apostasy or whatever. All right. Go ahead. Next.
The warning passages in the New Testament addresses regenerate people, not merely professing people, and they express real dangers to the regenerate. The danger, however, is not loss of salvation, but severe temporal divine discipline. That's, you know, people did not focusing in that very, very, very important or necessary thing in order to specify the loss of salvation or the to receive a gift, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, possibly even physical death. Yeah. Yeah. As well as shame and loss of reward at the judgment seat of Christ. Six, a life of good works is the intended and commanded outcome of justification, but it's not inevitable, Romans 8:12. Those who have believed on Christ, those who have believed on Christ, will you explain to me, like, differentiate between the in Christ, on Christ, of Christ?
Those who have believed on Christ, this means they trusted on him for salvation.
What? How about in Christ?
So this is like the idea they have depended on Christ, but they believed.
They
believe in Christ. It's kind of pretty much the same.
What about of Christ?
Believed of Christ? That could be like about Christ. Keep going.
How about if we said in Christ, meaning person? When it says of Christ, which means his ministry. What about if on Christ, meaning his work on the
what
cross?
About you write that down and you work on it and explain it to me from scripture later on. Good ideas, but we'll talk about it later. Okay.
Those who have believed on Christ and have been first, because I was struggling with that when I explained to them in my debate on the Facebook, so I just
okay. All right.
Those who have believed on Christ and have been regenerated by His Holy Spirit can never fall away from salvation. They shall be preserved in a state of salvation to the final hour and be eternally saved. This preservation is guaranteed regardless of the amount of works or lack thereof in the believer's life, John 6, 38-40. The motive for, number eight, the motive of godly living is not to be found in either fear of losing salvation, or Arminian's view, or wondering if one is saved, experimental predestinarian. Rather, it is to be found negatively in the fear of disapproval, and positively in gratitude for a salvation already assured, anticipating the master saying, "Well done." Oh, this is the one that I said earlier. The doctrine of eternal rewards usually has a more prominent place in encouraging a life of good works in the Christians or partner view than in Arminian or experimental predestinarian views.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
So,
I used the
if I can get CJ to let me know which ones he agrees with and which one he disagrees with, then we can narrow the debate and focus in on that. That doesn't mean we'll get to everything at this time.
Yeah. I pray that that his pride will allow it, okay?
Right.
Because pride is the most don't want.
Yeah, and that's why I said if you can land close to this, mm-hmm. then let's stop with the antinomian mess. The accusation. Okay. Put mm-hmm. forth your exegesis and even your church history. Lordship salvation, like that taught by MacArthur, is a reflection of Puritan Calvinism and not the typical Reformed approach. Okay? And see what I'm doing here? I'm trying to refute Lordship salvation by explaining that what's typically associated with Lordship salvation is not the typical Reformed approach. I'm saying, CJ, look, you can be Reformed, but you can't be Lordship. Or you shouldn't be Lordship. Anyway. CJ, you already identified as not your typical Calvinist by revealing that you're a four-pointer. Okay? The question is, will you end up sovereign grace or free grace? I believe you may become free grace because you understand people have different baggage, and so sanctification looks differently. Because he talks a lot about drugs and alcohol and people struggle and all of that. I believe I impressed you about Solomon, and if it's possible that he's saved, then it's possible for a carnal believer to worship demons. Sadly, if you have a false gospel, it is more demonic than anything you see on Halloween. Because he recently did a video on Halloween. All right. And then this is some of the resources about the falsifiable stuff. Andy Nassali in his 1 Corinthians ESV commentary, which I'll show in a minute, basically makes an argument for why he doesn't believe that people are saved. And he's depending on this guy named Andrew Wilson, who wrote this thing called the Warning Assurance Relationship of 1 Corinthians. And then there's an article that I'm going to show from it, Relationship Between Warnings and Assurance, Don't Fumble It. And Bob Wilkin replied to that in the New Assurance, Assured, Not Yet Assured. Well, Thomas Schreiner, in his 1 Corinthians commentary in Tyndale, he says, perhaps Paul speaks phenomenologically, using the language of appearance for the sake of pastoral admonition. In other words, Paul's only talking to them as if they're saved, but they're not really saved. And then D.A. Carson, in his article, Reflection on Assurance, goes into more details and things like that about
that. So maybe the audience that time is Paul already shared the gospel, but there's some believe and there's some not. So maybe, you know.
Yeah. Paul's only addressing believers.
I think the people.
Okay, so this is the ESV commentary. It's talking about the hypothetical argument in 1 Corinthians 15. And then this is where it makes a reference. I was working on my paper for 1 Corinthians 15 when I found this. And then it gives the footnote where you go in and finding out about Andrew Wilson, the Warning Assurance. So it says right here, for a person to destroy the church is different from a church teacher building on the foundation of flammable materials. So the caveat in verse 15 about God saving the builder does not apply here. God is warning everyone, church teacher, church member, and anyone else, that they will experience eternal judgment if they destroy God's church. So he makes it sound like they can go to hell, right? Here's the book. It's $96. I can't afford it right now. So, and I think it's in German. Maybe it's in English now, but
this is can't afford right now because he is supporting wife.
Yes. Anyway, so here's the article by Wilkin where he replies to it. Here's the link for the website. It takes you to the Andrew Wilson stuff. And this is the relationship between warnings and assurance. Don't fumble it, where you can go read about it at the Gospel Coalition. Here's the Schreiner commentary. Here's the quote. Perhaps Paul speaks phenomenologically using the language of appearance for the sake of pastoral mission. And this is what CJ's argument is. That brother doesn't mean brother. It just means the pastor is talking to everybody as brothers. And this is the journal that D.A. Carson is in. Reflections, Christian Assurance. And I'm tired right now, so I'm not going to go forward. But you see, I have so much stuff, you know. And I have more. I mean, I'm just going to skim some stuff. Some of this is from other debates that we use to clarify things. If he says, I don't know Greek, here's my transcripts in Hebrew, same thing. The classes I've taken, me translating Greek in this webinar before I ever was in seminary, me teaching intermediate Greek, me teaching intermediate Hebrew, my videos about writing my Hebrew exegesis paper in real time. And then here's the study on Necros and Thanatos if I need to get into that. More other stuff. This is my summary of the Gibbs debate. And this is what I see Gibbs did, and this is what CJ did. So I have this too. And so I'm going to decide what to bring in. Because I mentioned stuff in the videos, Janet, I could just tell people to watch the videos, which means I don't have to include them in the debate.
Yeah, sure. You're already done.
Yes, that's my point. And then here's more James stuff if we need to go into James. Just so much stuff. And I'm so tired. I gotta go to work after I take care of that other responsibility. So it's gonna be very hard to do this debate.
Yeah, because you're tired. So you work hard, Johnny. Thank you so much for doing that.
Yeah.
I pray that our plan, that's the reason why you work hard.
Yeah.
God will bless that,
Yeah, and I'm still not finished, still not even where I want to be. But you know what? It's just like when you write a sermon or you make a study or whatever, you just got to do your best and leave it the rest to God. There's always more that you can do. So do us a favor, Janet. Will you tell the audience what they can do?
Yeah.
Take your time so you don't forget anything, because you have 8 minutes. I don't think you're going to be talking for 8 minutes, but you never know.
People will be if I'm talking. So anyway, guys, thank you so much for being with us, and I thank God for that. And please continue to watch the Lehman Seminary's YouTube videos there, so that you're able to understand what's my husband's perspective or thoughts about everything that he discussed, this debate, his previous debate, and the future debate that he will have. So please, if you want to know Charlie or the Lehman Seminary, please go to his channel and watch the videos. And so that next time when you comment in the comment section, every time he appears on online, you know him. You have a good thoughts, or you have a thoughts that correctly describe his teaching and his personality also, and how my husband devoted to study God's word in order to teach to other people, so that people also that heard my husband teaching will also teach to others. So guys, thank you so much, and please keep this ministry in prayer. And my husband always say this in last part, like, if you let God to donate or to help with this ministry to keep and continue, though we keep on continuing. I mean, electricity and Wi-Fi is not free. So if you are led by God to do that, please help my husband to in order that how should I say, to help him. So thank you so much if that is so, that you will do it. Thank you so much, and keep praying for you who are listening this, that may God will bless you always, especially if you are on deep doing Bible study, more intimate relationship in God's word by doing exegesis. Yeah, thank you. My husband is laughing right now.
Yeah, because you took about 2.5 minutes to say goodbye. So the only thing I'll add is Janet forgot to mention where the link is. It's underneath the trailer video if you want. It's a PayPal link. And but yeah. Anyway, I hope y'all blessed by Janet as I am. God bless.
Yeah. No, wait. Yeah, you did that already. Will you like, yo, yeah, yo, before you
Oh, you want
sleep?
me to rap? Okay.
Yeah, about this, the
I'm
conclusion, the
about to
sum.
debate CJ Cox. I'm going to see that dude and say, yay, say, kick rocks, because you don't think that you really spit truth. Nah, man, dude, you need to sit through what I have to say to you. I don't even know what will come out my word, about my mouth. I'm trying to do the best I can, but it seems like nothing's coming out. Right now, I'm getting my PowerPoints all organized because you never know how I'm going to be putting up with your lies. Sometimes you're telling the truth, but you don't even know you're lying because you got caught up in so much stuff it's disguising. Because Satan is a subtle serpent that's always deceiving. Ready for that? No wonder leaving you grieving. You see, the truth is that we got to get to the grace because that's the only way that you're going to be free in this space. Everything that Janet goes with the mocking, it don't matter. I'm still going to start talking. So, CJ Cox, Mr. Synagogue, I'm so glad that you believe in God
I
and
thought
I
that
want
he's
you to get
Cyclone.
away from the Lordship and come to Christ and free grace and worship. Janet thought your name was Cyclone. What can I say about that? More like Cyclops. Well, it don't matter what I say because I know that it's going to hit you in the eye gate. And everything's gonna be fine because I'm gonna be the best to rhyme. And hopefully, I got 3 minutes. Should I go as a gimmick? I don't know. I'm not a gimmick, so let me mix this. You see, I spit this. And so, what I wanna talk about is James chapter 2. And what you see is that the Calvinists come after you. They wanna try to make you think that your faith isn't genuine. Why? Because they want to see that you're small and insignificant. Because as they look down on you, they can feel better about themselves. They could put the rewards on their shelf, but they don't believe in rewards, right? Some of them do. What can you say about that? Some rewards they pursue. Others to say that the faith that Christ gave was to me as a gift when I was generated. So all of that's going to be incinerated. But you know what? I find that evidence incriminating because they got different systems that constantly contradict. And you see that it's nonsense, kid. They need to get back and change their correspondence to the way that affects how when I responded, because I come at them harder than they ever imagined. What can you say about that? Deeper than they can fathom. What even happened? They wonder what this kid is rapping. Right now, I got a hurt tooth, but I'm still spitting. Never be forgetting, trying to do my best to keep living. I don't want to have a toothache to be in pain all day, but what can I say? My wife wants me to go all the way, and so I am spitting this stuff freestyle. 2 minutes to go. Is he going to give up the flow, give up the ghost? I don't think so. Why? Because I have so many things to talk about. There's so much stuff that I want to give a shout out. So many stuff that I could put into this PowerPoint. I could be here for an hour, boy, writing down everything that I could say in a debate. But 20 minutes is not enough to set your fate. So it's going to be one verse, two verse, maybe even three debate. I don't understand. Can he even debate? All he wants to hem haw and give his antidotes. And you know what? I think the dude's going to have to choke. He's got a whole lot for me. Yeah, right. More like he's going to give me a story. Talk about addiction and how bad it is. Talk about that you're not safe if you did those deeds. Well, it's okay because we know what the biz is. And you know what? He needs to get with the business. That's what Jesus said. He said, seek his righteousness. And you know what? I'm not the fighting kid. I'm trying to tell you that the Sermon on the Mount's about discipleship. You need to get to studying the Bible tip. Never let me slip 1 minute to go. So I'm spitting this flow to let everybody know to look into your soul. And it's not talking about positional salvation. It's talking about experiential, like outpatient, like when you go to the hospital when you got wounds, when you do the best you can because you swoon. You've been so many problems into the room and you need to be refreshed. You need to be blessed and you don't know what is next. That's why James chapter
This is the
5 talks
next.
about restoration. So what can you say then? I'm trying to do the best to tell you about sozo. Don't get mad at my flows, be so cold. I'm trying to tell you about the salvation so you can have the blessedness. You need to be confessing him, but confessing him is not what saves. It's believing the one moment that frees you from them chains. Positionally, lyrically, that's what I'm spitting, and never be forgetting. You think the chart's made up, that it's not falsifiable. I'm going to hold you liable for libel. Why? Because you need to get back to the Bible, quit the
And
accusation.
don't
Because
point.
I